Welcome to Live from Size Lounge, weekly conversations with alumni of Iowa State University. At the ISU Alumni Association, we strive to facilitate the lifetime connection of Cyclones everywhere, communicating, connecting, and celebrating Cyclone Pride. This series is made possible thanks to the more than 43,000 members of the Alumni Association. If you are interested in staying connected to the university and receiving all the benefits and services of being a member, visit isualum.org to learn more.
Good afternoon and welcome to Live from Size Lounge. My name is Matt Van Winkle. We are excited to welcome Andrew Lopez as our guest today. Andrew is a writer, director, actor, and stand-up comic now living in Los Angeles. He graduated from Iowa State in 2012 with a degree in communication studies, and in the past few years has worked on movies including Mike and Dave Need Wedding Dates, The House, and Blockers. But it's been on the stage where Lopez has recently taken his career to the next level, touring the world with stand-up comedian Joe Coy. And it's on Netflix where you can watch Lopez on Coy's new special, In His Elements, where they travel to Manila, spotlighting the local culture and featuring Filipino-American entertainers. Please help me in welcoming Andrew Lopez.
What up, man?
How are you?
I'm good. Thanks for having me. This is so cool. You look so rich with that awesome Iowa State background.
I know, man. We have a great graphic designer here on staff who made this print. But I am in the Alumni Association right now here in Ames, and I know you're actually in Iowa right now, right?
I'm in Iowa, in the motherland. It's I love it actually. It's like it's such a good break. I got back here like maybe a month ago, since like, you know, all the spikes with the COVID virus hitting with Los Angeles. I was like, I gotta go back home, dude. It's gonna be so much chiller there than Los Angeles.
Yeah. So you grew up in Pella, right?
Yeah, I grew up in Pella, and then graduated in 2008. Went straight to Iowa State, and after Iowa State, I went to Los Angeles. But I'm Iowa, like born and bred.
That's awesome. Yeah. So talk about your time here at Iowa State when you were a student. Kind of how did it prepare you to get to where you're at today? I know you were communication studies, right?
Yeah. Yeah, let's start there. I mean, with my major, I think I declared communications like my junior year. It was kind of like my major that was the one that was going to get me out, I think, like in a way that I could stay on track. But I think my time at Iowa State was amazing. It was just like I think a lot of people probably can relate to this. That kind of in the field of arts at Iowa State, but I knew what I wanted to do. I just didn't know how to find that concentration when I first got there. Sure. And so it was a lot of exploring. Like I did, I think like design for a little bit. I did like, I think I did like English, and I realized I wasn't disciplined enough for that. And then eventually I found a good advisor that was like, you should be communications. You know what you want to do. We can kind of like mold a course around that. My junior year is when we figured that out. But I got there in 2008, and I lived at Larch. I met all my best friends. My random roommate my freshman year, I still live with in Los Angeles. We're still roommates.
That's cool.
And then I felt a lot of emotions and partied a lot and met a lot of cool people, met a lot of awesome teachers, got super involved. I started working at the student union board like my freshman year. And then lo and behold, like 4 years later, I just, I got out of there, but I mean, that's kind of the quick cliff notes. It was amazing.
So when you were doing that type of work, from what I remember, you and I kind of go back, you and I went to school together, but I remember you were like
my actual friend. So
I know.
Like a reunion for us.
It's perfect. That's great. So I remember when you were a student though, you were actually responsible for like booking talent to come to Iowa State, right?
Yeah. I think, so how that happened, it was like, me and my friend, Brian Sheckel, who I went to, who's also, another graduate from Iowa State and also went to, Pella with me in high school. We knew we wanted to do entertainment when we got to Iowa State, but it was kind of one of those things where it's like in Iowa, like there's not really, you know, an entertainment like option. So what ended up happening was like we tried to find anything we could to kind of get in that field. And then we heard about the student union board was responsible for booking bands and Visha and doing like kind of just entertainment adjacent stuff in terms of what it could do for the school. So we started volunteering there as, you know, just working the door at the M shop and then working like the comedians that would come to the Great Hall and stuff. We would just be volunteers, and that eventually led to us winning or like kind of like applying and winning the seats as directors. So me and Brian did that together. And the Cinderella story of that all was like, we were responsible then for actually booking the artists and working with their agents. And that's how I got my foot in the door. And Brian got his foot in the door in music that way. And now he was working for Childish Gambino. And I ended up working in Los Angeles as, you know, at CAA was my first job. But, you know, that was our first foot in the door. And that's what we did is we to try to get our foot in the entertainment through Iowa State. They kind of gave us the keys to do that through getting involved.
So you moved out to LA shortly after you graduated. So how difficult was it to really get on that scene and being so fresh from Iowa, you know, a kid from small town Iowa to move out to LA and have big dreams of, you know, working in the film industry, right?
It was pretty weird. I mean, I to give people like the kind of vibe that it was like, I don't know if anyone's ever seen that HBO show Entourage, but it was like, that was my first job. I was an agent assistant. I was Lloyd from Entourage. I like worked for agents at the biggest agency in the world, was kind of my first job out there. And it was pretty scary, but it was like, you know, I'll say this, like the best way I could segue into that story is that I think like Iowa State was really kind to me when because I was lucky enough to know that I wanted to make movies and be like a storyteller. And I think the thing that Iowa State did very well was that like, they have so many options for you to find whatever it is you want to do to get better at. And maybe you have to kind of piece together the adjacent things that make it. But when we found out that Sub was involved with working with Hollywood, like they were booking these comedians, booking these acts, like getting these movies to come play at Iowa State, I told the advisor that ran Sub that I wanted to be a storyteller and I wanted to be in Hollywood and work in Hollywood. And he had the connection. So he really like molded me and got me ready for that life. So while I was at Iowa State, it was like, you know, we were working with agencies like to book these comedians. And I was starting the rapport of that. I was getting to learn the language of it, like the language of how to speak to those people. I was getting to learn contracts, how the money worked, and then how to take care of artists when they got to Iowa State. So I saw that kind of life through Iowa State kind of giving me that first foot in. So when I got to LA, it was hard personally, but I was confident enough to be like, I've done this before. I've seen the first step at college. And I think like, you know, Iowa State kind of, and my friends kind of gave me the confidence to be like, you know, have a little bit of a thick skin and know that I could do it, if that makes sense. Yeah,
absolutely, man. And I know you spend a lot of time writing as well. You've been in some movies. You spend a lot of time on stage as a stand-up comedian, but a lot of your time is spent writing for
shows
and web scripts and stuff like that. Talk about the challenges that kind of come with writing and like maybe any advice you'd have for people that want to get into this.
It's pretty, I mean, I think writing is different for everybody, you know. I write screenplays and TV shows. Right now I'm on one of the reasons why I'm back in Iowa is that I sold a TV show to a network and a TV show that I'm going to star in and writing and producing. And so I'm back in Iowa just writing that. And it's a story about like me growing up in Iowa. And Yeah. And it's the biggest thing I've done and the thing I'm the most proud of so far. And it's like, I would say that like my advice for people is you should write a lot the way that makes the most sense for you. Whatever you find fun in writing, that's the place to focus on. Whether it's like, you know, and it can be in anything. It could be in journalism. It could be in, you know, blogs or in my case, screenplays. But I think anything that makes you interested in fun, you know, like there's a lot of tediousness to writing. And Jordan Peele has this really good quote that, you know, he made Get Out and Key and Peele. And his quote is follow the fun. If you're stuck on something, or if you're bored, or if like you feel like what you're writing isn't good, skip that part and go to the part that you want to write that you think is interesting to you. And that's kind of how I found the story that became my biggest sale as a TV show. And it was just like, you know, it'd be fun is to write about Iowa. And lo and behold, it became like my big thing. And then like,
that's pretty cool. Yeah.
Yeah. And the other thing I'll say about that too is the scariest part about writing is it gets really lonely. And so I think you have to live life at the same time. Like, you're not beholden to your work. I think your life isn't work. And so for me specifically, like, I think I can only write if I'm out living life at the same time, you know, to get inspired.
That's awesome. What can you tell us more about the show that you're working on? It's about your kind of your life. Like, what, when can people expect that? Is it down the road a bit, or when?
Yeah, we're on pilot right now. I don't think I'm allowed to talk about it.
I figured.
it is cool. It's like, you know, it's, we sold it, and there's some really cool producers involved in it. And it's it's the focus is on, it's a love letter to Iowa in a really cool way. I don't think in a way people have seen before. And it's, we're really excited about it. It feels authentic and funny. And it lives in a space where I think is very like, it's going to make people feel really proud, I think, to be from here.
Very cool. And I know that you have recently been spending a lot of time at comic clubs, you know, on stage, working on your stand-up comedy career. That's really taken off for you, hasn't it?
It's definitely, I mean, I owe a lot to, I think, being at the right place at the right time. But that's, I think, how you and I met, is that I started comedy.
Yep. Grandma Mojo's, right?
Yes. Yeah. I was in one of the improv Wednesday nights at the M Shop. There's like an improv group that I was in. I was so bad, dude. I was like not good. I think I was the worst.
People don't know though. People don't know it's good or bad, you know, when you're in college. It's just funny.
Yeah, totally. I guess that's the cool thing, right? Is that it's just like, it was an outlet. And that's one thing that I look back on, and I don't think I realized how, you know, it's one of those things where you don't realize how amazing things are until they're gone, you know? And in college, I now look back and realize how nice the other students were to me when I was doing stand-up in college and doing Grandma Mojo's, because I was not good. And they were very supportive of me getting better. I started in college. I wasn't very good, but they gave me a lot of outlets. That's the other thing about Ames that I think a lot of my friends I talk to that also started in college that are from different colleges or different places that I've met in LA now is while we're chasing this career is that like my first couple of years trying to start stand up in Los Angeles is I had a lot more opportunities than I think a lot of my friends did in other colleges, because I think Iowa State, weirdly, like you could just, like I said earlier, you could find the things that could help you figure out what you wanted to do. And we had open mic nights. We were booking some of the best comedians. I ended up becoming the person that booked those comedians. And I think one of the reasons why I did that is so I could open for those comedians when they came. And then, they had like Visha Says I'm Funny back when Visha was a thing. And Grandma Mojo's, like you mentioned. And so when I got to LA from Ames, it was like I had some experience, but it was very much like trying to figure out now, like how to make money doing it and how to get an agent. And that was really, really hard. It was like a lot of time I slept on floors my first couple months in Los Angeles. I had no friends. I was like, I lived in my car. Like I would do this thing where I would like wake up at like 8 a.m. to work at my job at the agency. I was making like $600 a week, like no money in Los Angeles. And then I would work from 8 a.m. to like 8 p.m. and like, you know, at the agency, like I'm working next to like people who graduated from Harvard and like Brad Pitt is walking in the door. And I was like scared to speak to anybody. And I wanted to be like this comedian, actor, writer. And I was like leaving the agency in my suit, going to open mics, performing for like 3 people, bombing, sleeping in my car. Cause like we'd get done at like 1 a.m. and then like I'd park at like a Walmart, sleep in the car, drive back to the agency, shower in the locker room, and then like go back and just repeat. And that was kind of my life for like 2 years when I was starting out.
That's crazy. Well, now you have been touring the world with comedian Joe Coy, who I know you were recently in a Netflix special with. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, I met Joe. So Joe Coy is like a very like giant comedian and he's been doing it for so long, and he's also Filipino, and obviously I very prideful Filipino person. So I think I grew up watching Joe my entire life. I think my first Vishesism, like the first time I ever did stand-up, was 2009 in college at Vishesism Funny, and I pretty much stole one of Joe's jokes at that show. It's like, it was pretty much like ripping Joe Coy off. And then lo and behold, like, you know, I ran into Joe at a restaurant in 2018. I had just been in a movie called Blockers. Like, I just acted in that movie, starring like John Cena and produced by Seth Rogen and Evan Goldberg. And it was kind of like, you know, the movie was doing pretty well, and Joe had just saw the movie, and there's not very many Filipinos that are in the industry that's, you know, for lack of better words, like out there and in the mainstream. And Joe is like the top of it. So when he saw that movie and he saw me in there, it's like very quickly you can tell when another person's Filipino. You're like, oh, that person's Filipino. He saw that. And then after he saw the movie, he went to a restaurant, and I was at that restaurant, and I had approached him and said, like, you're one of my favorite comedians. You inspired me when I was a kid. And he was like, I think I know you, dude. I think I saw you in a movie. And then that clicked, and we started just hanging out as friends. And then I asked him if I could open for him. And then he asked me to come out on the road. And then I was on the road for like 2 years, and I saw the whole world. We went to almost every single state, and Joe is gigantic. So we're playing like arenas. Like we played, you know, the Chicago Theater 3 nights in a row, sold out. We played, you know, Radio City Music Hall. You know, we did, you know, San Diego 7 nights in a row, sold out. And Joe is just a beast who just taught me how to be not only like an amazing stand-up and to put my feet to the fire and, you know, get out there in front of thousands of people, but he also taught me how to be a better businessman and market myself and be a good person and pay it forward at the same time. So that was cool.
Talk about that experience being back in the Philippines, because I know you guys are both, you know, your families are from there at least. What was it like, that experience, like to tape that special and kind of be back? And because are your parents from the Philippines or?
Yeah, my parents are from the Philippines. And then they moved to Pella, which is a movie in itself, I feel like.
I guess they both start with P. So maybe they were like, yeah, Philippines, Pella, it's
similar. That seems like, that seems comfortable. Let's go
with that.
They both have two L's in it. Is that right?
Sure. There you go.
It's my parents are from the Philippines, so it was really cool. I've never been before, and my parents are amazing. They're the best parents in the world, and you know, they immigrated to Iowa so I could have a better life. And I think I'd heard so many stories about the Philippines, and I've always wanted to go, and it was kind of like a dream scenario to be able to go for Netflix and have Netflix pay for it. And Netflix sent us there, and that was kind of Joe's dream of what that special meant, is that like, we all know that our parents, any immigrant, any child of an immigrant understands this, is that your parents, if they immigrated to America, ideally came here to give their family a better life. And it's nice to go back and be able to see that I'm a comedian now, and I can do this silly thing, like perform and be selfish enough to believe that everybody wants to hear my story. So it's kind of nice to go back to the motherland and the roots of where I got that opportunity and that privilege came from, and get to see how it connects, that like, this is what my roots are, this is what my parents came from, and this is also the kind of people and culture that made me who I am today, and why I have the privilege to be able to be on stage and speak about them.
What's the best thing about being able to perform and make people laugh? I mean, you must get some real fulfillment about being able to entertain people in that way.
It's a double-edged sword, I think, with entertainment. I think one of the crazy things about entertainment is that it's like, at the very heart of it, all of us want to connect with people. And I think, and then you have to navigate the business part of it, which is very, very strange. So I think I don't think this is only with entertainment. I think it's with anything with connecting with people, is that, you know, it's, you know, you want, especially nowadays in 2020, with how I think the country feels more divided than ever. And I think that, you know, With the coronavirus, it's made us more isolated as well. And with social media, you just get so much, you know, you're feeling so much and seeing so much that I think more now than ever, people want to feel connected and you want to find universal aspects that bring us together. And that's kind of where the heart of what I wanted to do, why I got into entertainment and it originally came from. So I want to find how that connects again in 2020 as an adult that's pursuing entertainment. Like, how do I tell stories that connect people and the positive way of doing that and find a middle ground? And I guess what I mean by that is I remember the first movie that made me be like, I want to tell stories. I want to get on stage or I want to make movies was Independence Day. And it was like, I was like a 7 years old and I saw Independence Day, and that's a movie about aliens, you know, like coming in and destroying America and the rest of the world, and Will Smith and Jeff Goldblum save the day. And it's like two people who would never speak to each other, like join forces. And like, and then they have the speech from Bill Pullman being like, America, like, let's get together. It's not only America, it's the world. Like, we're going to defeat it for humankind. And I guess like what I mean by that is like, that's a movie about aliens, but the heart of it is about people coming together. And like, whether you're from, you know, whether you're black or white, whether you're Jewish and you're from Compton, you know, like they get together to defeat the aliens. And even when I was like 7 years old, I was like, I want to do that. I want to tell stories like that. And so I find a lot of fun and fulfillment from trying to figure out how I can do that now.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, you've probably been doing a lot of writing in your free time. Now, I know you said you're working on your show, but you could probably work on a lot of material now that you guys can't really go into clubs and perform, right?
Yeah, it's definitely, and I think, yeah, it's a lot of material building now, and it's, you know, we're living in clown world kind of, so there's a lot of material to like mine from now with everything going on and craziness in the headlines and the craziness that's happening just, you know, out of our control with, you know, the virus and stuff. So I think with great sadness also comes a lot of like great, you know, things to laugh at. You know, I find there's a fault in taking things too seriously sometimes. And so it's kind of fun, I think, right now for me to like sit here and understand and feel everything that's happening and understand how this is affecting a lot of people. But also I think a lot of us are ready to also just be like, hey, we can hopefully find a time to laugh about this too, you know?
Yeah. And I know you got to come back and perform in Ames recently, right? With Joe, you were playing at Stevens, right?
Yeah, that was crazy, dude. Especially after living in Larch my entire
right.
My window was facing Stevens. And I remember the first time I went and saw a show at Stevens, a play at Stevens. And I was always like, I want to perform on a stage someday. And then, you know, I worked Stevens a couple times. We booked like Reggie Watts when I was in college. And we booked Nick Offerman from Parks and Rec. And I remember being like, wow, this would be so cool to be someone to perform there. And then, yeah, I opened for Joe in that auditorium. And, dude, that theater is awesome.
Right? Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
But that was so cool. I will be honest. I think I was a little nervous, though. I don't think I did as well as I don't know what it is. It's like that thing where it's like I can perform in front of strangers, but when you perform in front of your friends and family, it's 10 times harder.
Yeah. And you talk about Iowa quite a bit in your material, I would imagine, because when you're out in California, people probably think of Iowa kind of as a foreign land, right? And people don't really know much about it, but people probably find that pretty funny.
Yeah, they dude, people don't realize how dope Iowa is. And I think like on the Netflix special, like I couldn't really talk about it as much, do my Iowa material, because I think everybody in the Philippines, I have no idea what you're talking about. Like people in the Philippines, it's so funny. Like that was one of the biggest culture shocks that I think like, I think naturally we understand this, especially being an Asian person, like naturally we understand this, but I didn't really feel it until I was there, especially on stage. But it's so funny to me because like in the Philippines, like being any other, like, cause I'm a minority in America as a Filipino. But in the Philippines, I'm not. So it's like they know more dogs than they know white people. You know what I mean? In the Philippines. So like when I'm talking about Iowa, they're like, yeah. We have no idea what you're talking about.
Right.
So I had to cut all that stuff away from the Netflix special. But yeah, I love talking about Iowa. But I think it's not what people think it's going to be. Like I think people always think I'm going to talk smack about Iowa. But I love Iowa. I think Iowa
is
the place on earth. So my material is always very pro Iowa, and I think that's probably why it does so well, because it's like I basically like talk like when I talk about Iowa on stage, it's basically like, do you guys want to feel loved, and like do you guys want to feel like calm and chill? You gotta go to Iowa.
Yeah,
and it's if anything, like if my career fizzles out at some point, I think I could get a job working for tourism at the state of Iowa.
That's awesome. I know you talk sometimes about like being from Pella and kind of being the only person that looked like you in that community. So you kind of get personal in your material.
Yes.
You have to be vulnerable, right?
Yeah. And I think that's the only way to do it. I also like, that's like another thing that if anybody here is listening for like advice, I guess, to get into like entertainment or how to move into that world or into storytelling, like that's another piece of advice. You have to follow the fun, but I also think like you find how you can make things that are very personal and vulnerable, but how you take something deeply emotional and make it entertainment is kind of the dichotomy of how you can succeed, I think, in the business of storytelling. And you know how like the best example I can give is that, you know how when someone tells you a story about a bad date, you know, like I went on a bad date and they're telling you that story and you're all laughing about it. Like you're laughing about something that like in the moment was deeply awful. Like that's kind of like what is kind of like the secret to telling stories that felt awful, but sometimes you can find the funny in it. And I think
for sure.
You're gaming in it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love that stuff. I love talking about very deeply personal things. One of the best advice I ever got from my mentor when I was working on movies like Neighbors and stuff, like my mentor that wrote that movie. One of the things that I found that is kind of the template for everything I want to do is that I want to treat all of my stand-up, all of the scripts I write like a wedding speech. And what that means is like you bring them in laughing. In the middle, you have them realize that you are talking about something deeply emotional. And by the end, hopefully they're crying. And by the last beat, you have one last joke that makes everybody be like, that was a good, that was real.
Nice. Awesome. Well, go check out the special on Netflix, Joe Coy in his element. In his elements? Am I saying that right? In his elements.
That's yeah. Watch Blockers. That's the best movie.
Blockers. Yep, that's right. And anything else that people can find you in or your work that I'm missing?
Yeah, I think you can find me on you can just find me on Instagram and stuff. And I love to hear from other people from Iowa. And I just love hearing stories about Iowa. And if you're in Los Angeles or you're in California, I want to meet up and hang out. So DM me. And I just DM me if you're from a Cyclone, because I love Iowa State.
Well, hopefully you guys can get back on the stage soon and back to entertaining people.
Yeah, man. Thanks for having me, dude.
Absolutely. All right. Good luck on your pilot and your show that's coming out soon, and keep us updated. All right, man.
Yeah. Appreciate you. Right. Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks, man. See ya. Yeah.